Yo, you are now listening to CalOne the God, aka the chef with the long hair. And this is Phone Tap Radio 2018. Compliments of New York Underground Radio.com. We got Dollar Bill on the one and twos. Of course, CalOne the God, Stack Wizzy Ones, Firstborn Man. We got Big DeeMo off the west side doing what he do. We got Doobie, aka Blanca from the Bronx. We got Kim Clark in the house. And we definitely got Lady Red and Sugar Shane on the things that they do. We got Rebecca S. We got my man Farouk the Great in the house. This is what we do. Lyric 757 is in the motherfucking house. We got Sibylla the Don in the house. Yes, indeed, we coming full stacked off the West Coast. We got my man Chris Tober holding it down. We got my man Spank Spank holding it down. And of course, it wouldn't be what it be without my man Stick Dominize. Act like y'all know what y'all listening to. This is Phone Tap 2018. Let's get it, y'all.
Like high beams, and now you niggas don't want me. That G code is official, yeah. Them goons is out to get you. I'm a Yonkers monster partner, and I'm dead in all the issues. You niggas can't get in with me, still rep them coroners to Florida. If you think you can spit in with me, you get one chance, and then I'm Florida. See, we ain't playing no games, straight octane from the mouth, though. And you should stay in your lane, or it's ear to ear with that ox, bro. So ask about us, or you better take a class about us. See, niggas couldn't last without us, yeah, they coming in last without. You dig? You ain't know my team heavy. Strap on deck with my team ready. You can talk all that fly shit, but niggas better know my team deadly. Coroners get them toe tags and them body bags for them MCs. Send your souls to the heavens and leave your physical empty. So make way for the Undertaker. Feel how that thunder shake you. Off the chains when I spit that. I hope you know where I'm gonna take you.
All your niggas talking shit will hear the toilet. If you fucking with the click, then you's a goner. What I do to pussy, nigga, I destroy it. Toe tag, body bag, nigga, I'm the corner. All y'all niggas talking shit won't hit the toilet. If you fucking with the click, then you's a goner. What I do to pussy, nigga, I destroy it. Toe tag, body bag, nigga, I'm the corner.
Worst is out. Rappers walk around with their purses out. Niggas talking all gangster when we the ones that should be worried about. It's real round here. Mad niggas get killed round here. A lot of blood gets spilled round here. But fuck that, cause it's my year. We piling bodies high, putting all you dudes in my scrapbook. For the love of this rap shit, you niggas taking your last look. We ill as it gets. You know me, a gorilla that spits. Locked and loaded with plenty of clips. Coroners is as ill as it gets. My nigga, we hang them high, bang them dry. My niggas here, and it ain't no lie. Only rock with the realest. Eyes red from that stimuli. I put the locks on the game, and only I got the combo. Back to back, we rolling heavy. 50 whips at your condo, so say my name. I'ma make y'all play my game. I hope y'all lames got aim, and a really high tolerance for pain. Ain't no need for the tough talk. I think hard, you tough walk. Your body hit the ground hard, then it outline you with dust chalk. Facts.
All your niggas talking shit will hear the toilet. If you fucking with the click, then you's a goner. What I do to pussy, nigga, I destroy it. Toe tag, body bag, nigga, I'm the corner. All your niggas talking shit will hear the toilet.
Yo, you know what it is. You're now rocking with NewYorkUndergroundRadio.com. This is Big DeeMo. Let's get it.
Yes, yes, yes, the God is in the building. You are now listening to Film Chat Radio 2018. This is CalOne the God, aka the Chef with the Long Hair. I'm here, of course, with my co-host and brother in arms, Big DeeMo. You know what I'm saying? Doing the things he does. What's up, DeeMo?
Well,
good to be here. I can't get on without you. Yeah. There's no us. You know, I got some special guests. You know, we definitely did it. You know what I'm saying? I'm happy to be here. I'm hype. I'm amped.
Yes, sir.
You know what I'm saying? I had a charm and glow pop before we got on. So
oh,
I'm
wow.
Up. I'm good.
Oh, man.
You know what I'm saying? Well, you already know. You know,
man,
we got
some
special guests online. And Dan Senior, be talking about your son. We got two special guests here. You know, and, you know, it's a pleasure for me. And I want to introduce these both because they both have multiple talents, you know, which I'll we'll get into along with everybody else on the panel today. So, you know, first off, I want to introduce my man Big Ant. You know what I'm saying? He is originally from the Bronx. You know what I'm saying?
Man,
you know,
man.
Yeah, we can hear you, man. You know what I'm saying? Good, man. Welcome in.
Sure.
Yeah, we can hear you, baby. You know what I'm saying? Welcome. Let me just say what he does. There you go. Because he is a connoisseur of hip hop. He is an entrepreneur and an oil painting artist.
Wow.
I don't think we've ever had this type of interview. So you're multi-talented. Welcome to the show, Big Ant. We appreciate it.
Thank you very much. It is a pleasure to be here.
I gotta introduce my brother over on the other side. And let it be known for everybody out there. I've known Ant forever, so this is not a trick. I've known Ant forever, so just in case y'all don't know Big Ant and CalOne, the God are people. As is, I'm gonna introduce King Street. What's going on, brother? And so welcome to us on the ground radio.
Thanks, shit. What's good? What's good?
Happy
King Street Smiles.
Alright, that's my big brother. Who I've known forever, and what he does is. It's a little bit different, but King is an entrepreneur. You know, he's definitely a people's person. Put some work in the community. He looked out for a lot of dudes. You know, one of my big brothers growing up, and he's also a filmmaker.
So, oh, right on.
This is interesting.
We got to play full camp.
You already know, so we're going to jump right into it. So, I'm going to start with you, Big Ant, and what I want to ask you about is, you know, you're an oil painter, and I've seen, you're an artist. Let me not say oil painter. You're an artist that specializes in oil painting, which is awesome, and I love what you do. How did you first get involved in that? You know, what were your motivations to start painting?
I have to rethink everything you said. I would just say I'm a creator. You know, I've drawn, I've painted. I'm talking about back in the day when we were kids, like me and you. So, I mean, it's not just crayons and color pencils. You know, it's going into these hobby stores, getting the little jars of the enamel paint, you know, painting toys and doing stuff like that. You know, and then because you're into it, you know, you just ask your parents, and my mom, you know, she was with it, you know, just ask about little art things you could take in school. You know, you're doing good in it, so she's not going to say no.
That's true.
You know,
that's true.
But, you know, like I said, with the basketball, just to kind of jump around, you know, traveling and everything. I just stuck with it, man. You know, I always kept a pad and a pen or I bought pencils on the road or I bought stuff out in different countries that I could bring back here. But when it was all said and done, or when I decided it was said and done with the ball, for me, the natural course was to go to the arts because that was just my natural God-given ability that I know I've had since day one.
That is absolutely awesome.
That's big.
And, you know, so then I got to flip the question back at you, King. You know what I'm saying? You know, how did you, you know, first become interested in, you know, starting the clothing line? And definitely we got to know about the filmmaking. You know, what were your motivations for learning how to get into those things right there in particular?
All right, well, let's just touch bases on the clothing line. The clothing line, you know, it's all about art, urban community, you know what I'm saying?
being able to cater to, you know, our, you know, the hip hop.
No doubt, urban community. No doubt about it.
I was able to hook up a God bless his dad, you know, a young man named D. Furf, you know, from 145th okay. Street. And, you know, he's one of those genuine brothers that was able to just kind of like give me the gift, man, and teach me how to put the ones and twos together when it comes to clothing games without, you know, hesitating or, you know how some people, they don't want to give you the secret ingredients, man.
That's
you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? They put you on, they kind of like keep it to themselves. Yeah, my brother, man, God bless his dad, man. He, you know, like I said, he dropped everything down to me about specs, going to manufacturing companies,
right,
you know, how to
right.
deal with these people, so on and so right. forth. And
so you went to a lot of sample shows and stuff like that for like fabrics and things like that?
Yes, yes indeed, man. And, man, all I do is, you know, was network, man, and absorb all the knowledge from these people, man. And, you know, I had a little fun, you know, dealing with that business. But the problem
I believe you did, too.
The problem is, man, with that clothing business, man, you really have to invest a lot of money
man.
Into that business, man, in order for you to really bang, you know, make it a banging situation. But man. As far as the filming business,
right?
I was like a critic, man. I love watching and rating movies, YouTube
okay.
videos, so on
okay.
and so
cool.
forth.
Cool.
And
cool.
I always said to myself, you know, man, I always had a visual mind. I said to myself, I know I can do this, and all I have to do is just get the right people around me so I can make this happen. You know, I love writing. So in order for me to pull this through, I had to put together my pen game and, you know, do auditions. Well, actually, yeah, the cameras and stuff like that.
Right.
And one thing I kind of like absorbed from other filmmakers, it doesn't cost that much to buy cameras along with additional equipment.
Right.
And again, this game was ran by the Irish people. Of course, they didn't drop no jewels to no minority people.
Yeah.
We always was taught that you have to have hundreds, thousands and thousands of dollars, billion dollars to be in this business.
Yeah.
When in fact, now minority people are learning the game. It don't cost that much money. It's
right.
about being creative and writing good.
Right.
And being able to sort out the right cast members, you know what I'm saying, to pull this through. Minority people are natural actors. You know
right,
what I'm saying?
We did discuss that. That's a fact. We did discuss that.
Right. They're natural actors, man. I mean, you could, a black person, you know what I'm saying, or a Latino person could say a few lines and you'll sit back and be like, or rather when they talk to you normally, right? Just being normal. Right? You be like, yo, listen to how he just delivered that, or listen to how she delivered that.
Looks good.
You know what I'm saying? Just imagine if you gave him some lines.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Some storyline or whatever for a scene.
Right.
And they delivered it the same way. It's no
right.
difference. You
right.
know what I'm saying? So all you have to do, once again, all you have to do is put together a good storyline for a movie.
Right.
You mess around and you know, and get a hit going. And this is what I'm working on.
Right.
I've written a script called Chronic Conflict. It's
okay.
You know, it's out on YouTube right now. You know,
right.
in the trailer. And I also written another movie as well. And along with a reality show, and I'm
ooh,
trying
okay.
to, you know, I'm trying to get this thing, filming business thing bubbling.
You touching on everything, man. Vinny,
that's
like awesome that you're all over the place. So, DeeMo, I gotta ask you,
What you got for these guys? What you got for
them? I got a question for each. We'll go with Ants first. As we kind of touched on this in the previous interview that isn't associated with this one, but I wanted to give a chance for the viewers tonight to kind of get the feel of what it was that had you motivated first. Was it the creation of art or the art itself that drew you in as your motivation?
That's a good question. I never thought about that.
Right.
So whether it was, I guess, the admiration or the creation, I would kind of say it was one and the same, because I can remember at a young age, before I was able to, before I could materialize the actual picture I saw before me, in my head, I knew I could do it.
Right.
Get so for me, it first started with recreation. You know, let me see if I can do that, because I know I can do that. You know, and then once I did it, I just kept expanding on that.
Gotcha.
And of course, I had a critic or two, you know, yeah, the nose is off. I mean, be it a cartoon, you're trying to, you know, draw a car.
Right.
Absolutely. I went through comic books, I went through the comic section in the newspaper. Yeah, I know back in the day, I know my uncle had bought me this book. It was like how to draw manga, like our manga comics. Like, step by step. I mean, I had that book when I was like about 8, I think. I had that book for years, so
wow.
I mean, it was just little things, man, you know. So you have these books that you're trying to copy and learn from, and then you have another book that's teaching you a style. And then I have my own thing that I like to do. And I don't know,
put your own stuff on it, basically.
It was like a blending, because for me it wasn't like, oh, let me see if I can do it better.
Right.
I want to see if I can do it different.
There you go.
Someone looked at a picture and said, you know what, I admire this, I like this. Well, I'm going to say, well, can I paint a similar or almost identical woman? Well, let's just say, once I'm painting a lot of, you know, black women, African women, Aboriginal, Indigenous
women. I'll paint those nice, too. You give it up, bro.
Yeah. So, you know, it was just a matter of saying, okay, that's a beautiful picture. Can I create a similar beautiful picture, a beautiful picture that's just as similar and get the same response but still look entirely different?
Okay.
You know, and so what I'm noticing with the twist that I'm putting on it, you know, that's where the background comes in, the training, my understanding. It's like, okay.
But then the background is in layers, though, and it's layers to it.
Well, life is in layers, you know, so I learned from my life. You know, and I put it in the art. You know, it's like, I told you this, but you know, I'm saying this on the show. A person's skin is layers. So if you're going to paint a picture, why would I want to paint it in one stroke?
Right.
Paint it in one layer. You know what I'm saying?
That's super smart right there.
And going back to the Jack Johnson I'm painting, or the other woman, the woman tiger, I started with a gold base. So there's certain levels of gold. I mean, I go from gold, copper, burnt umber, raw umber, sienna, different layers of what our skin actually looks like, you know?
Right.
And I incorporate that into the painting. So looking at the picture of Jack Johnson, this is a dark brother. You know, so I'm working at the base first and foremost gold because of the energy that he brings. So if nothing else, no one's really going to see the gold, maybe the highlights on the top, but the foundation of the picture is a gold of a human being, a black man, covered in gold. Yeah. And then you build a layer of blackness on top of that. Aren't we made from light? Aren't we consciousness? And aren't we built up in a certain way? Not just through melanin, but through evolving through life and everything else?
Correct.
Like that.
Wow.
Absolutely. You know, so with that being said, I want to both of y'all kind of like correlated. We got specialized into life itself. And these are the things that, you know, you may go through a day without hearing something like this. You know, so I'm very fortunate to sit here and listen to what y'all are saying. You know, so my next question is this. You know, and I'm going to start with you, King.
Hold on. I have one for King Streets, for sure.
And
I apologize, but I have to know, what film had the greatest impact on your motivation for film?
Good question.
That's good. Definitely a good question.
Blair Witch project.
Oh, nice.
Was that shit real?
It was smart, man.
The way they did it. Right. What's crazy about it is it was just so simple. You know, I mean, simple to put together. And as far as the money that was invested in doing that film, I mean, it was less than $10,000.
Right.
So when you start thinking about, the creativity of that film,
right,
and the amount of money that was invested into that film, it touched me and it makes me say, if the individuals that put together that film can do that with a short budget, you know, which is considered a low budget movie.
Was it an indie film?
Yes.
Exactly.
Right, but then they pushed that film through.
Those same
individuals that did that film also made Paranormal Activity.
Right.
Okay. And those particular films as well, low budget, but gross a lot of money, millions and millions of dollars. So my point is, just looking at that, I'm saying to myself, you know, if they can do this, you know, work on those projects, I would love to do projects as such and become successful from it. But my number one film that I am motivated by is Scarface.
There it is.
As far as the acting, you know, the acting, the creativity, the audio, the visual, everything was great. But that the writing, everything was great about that movie. That movie itself inspired me.
So this leads me to ask you, because you basically answered a part of another question I was going to ask you. I hear you, Biggie Smalls.
Yeah.
I was going to ask you with this, okay. At what point did you know you had it and you could do it? Like, what was the project that made you think you could do it?
Right.
Because I got to ask you that too, because that's definitely a creative question.
Well, one of the things that motivated me and they gave me confidence to believe I could do it is after observing and learning from some other artists, filmmakers, they kind of like was tutoring me and I went to film school and I learned quite a few different things. You know, the tricks, the trades, the do's, the don'ts. Once I put together that, built my confidence, and, you know, I did a couple of small projects for the school that I went to. And, you know, once they had kind of like bigged me up and I received a certificate and completion of cinematographic, you know, and editing, I was happy, you know, and that gave me the confidence to feel that, you know, I was able to do it and it motivated me to want to work on my own personal projects. If that answers your question.
That's good.
So, and I want to throw the same question at you, man. And that's awesome, man. I appreciate that. That is really awesome.
I like that.
Look out. Okay. you know me. I'm always thinking, so please repeat the question. When was it you knew you could do that thing?
Yeah, and that's kind of where I got lost, you know, because I was thinking, and I'm laughing because I know sometimes I may sound arrogant or cocky, but the same thing, you know, it's not even the confidence. It's like you just know. I know that when I open my eyes that my skin is black. I know that I have an ability and I can accomplish certain things. So for me, it was just a matter of translation. You know, knowing that I was able to learn something like basketball and take it and apply it in a way and do things in certain places on the planet, even imprint in terms of not just people's minds and hearts, but, you know, records or whatever else.
Right.
Okay, I've taken something of my own being and my own energy on the level of marketing and exposure, creativity and talent. And, you know, and I put it out of my physical being in a certain way.
I just want to say this, you know what I'm saying? At the moment, I think we need to definitely take a pause and station identification. So, Ant, I want you to hold that up. We're going to definitely come back to it. I want to let y'all know you're now listening to Inside Radio 2018. I'm here with BiGG, you know what I'm saying? Artist, hip-hop connoisseur, entrepreneur. I'm also here with King Street's entrepreneur, filmmaker, and of course my producer that makes it happen every day, Big DeeMo. This is CalOne of God, aka the Chef of the Long here. We're going to take this first for station identification break.
New York Underground Radio.
Yo, what's up, man? What?
Yo! It's punk motherfucker throwing shit at us,
yo,
man.
Yo, I smell something, man. You smell something?
I definitely smell something.
You smell
my
something?
Hair.
I smell
pussy!
Pussy!
We're gonna use what we got to get what we want.
Yo, it's your boy G5, Mr. No More State Greens, Top Gun of Baghdad. And right now I'm rocking with New York Underground Radio with my nigga CalOne of God. Let's get it.
New shit, we about to hit the studio.
This is Firstborn Man rocking with CalOne of God. New York Underground Radio.
It's your boy Mel, MBM, kicking in with CalOne of God on the ones and twos. Stay tuned to some real shit, man.
Ahoy, mates. What's poppin'? You already noticed the West Indian Pirate Prince, Al Guest. I'm rockin' with motherfuckin' CalOne of God on New York Underground Radio. It's that Saturday night smackdown, man. Smackin' niggas down, you know what I'm talkin' about. Shout out all my felony fellas, shout out all my OBS, shout out Take Money, shout out the Top Gunner gang, bang bang pirate gang, you already know what it is, man, be setting sail on these niggas, man, yo CalOne, man, smack these niggas down, man.
My name is Callie P, and my name's Tyson, and we're rocking with CalOne of God.
Yo, if we got a problem, I be solving them in honor. Make shit look like it's Pearl Harbor. It be car round route like Carver. Me and homie show up to your fate. Nothing but a barber. Cut you sobbing, don't you argue. All I'm robbing, definitely bombing. Why they on me? I hear nothing but my gracious God is calling. Carry out your orders, I don't care if they are alarming. With this message, trust me, they can't harm me. Might as well bring your whole army. I am charming to the point these bitches turn burn down the joint. Why you sleeping, DeeMo creeping, y'all sock leaping through your window, tater toppers to your pillow, to you feel low, I won't kill slow, yeah I did it, fuck it, Winslow, not just only where the pin goes, I was up here trying to delete all your kinfolk, I'm suspenseful.
We bombing, you don't want no smoke like bombing, we bombing, you don't want no smoke like bombing, we bombing, you don't want no smoke like bombing, we bombing, you don't want no smoke like bombing.
Henüz bir canavara dönüşmemişken sıkıcı gidiş gelişler
Yasa bir deli mi demişler, bakış açını genişlet. Yaz burada bak işte, endişeler bence bileş. Afişe eder pet şişeler, kapalı gişe. Endişelenmen normal adamım, anlıyorum seni. Problemlerimi mikrofonumla paylaşmak beni epey bir gerdi. Sıradaki gelsin sigaram dönsün. Orta Doğu'daki bir masum çocuk öleceğini Trump'ın deli velet ölsün. Big brother'ımı bırakın bir deli görsün. Ve de gerçekleri görmezler, sıradan şeyler söylerler. İnanacağımız umurlarında değil, inanmayacağımızı da bilirler. Ve bu işler yaz sen boşver, bir kere de kötü zamanda hoş gel. Paraları serpiştirmişim hep, bittiğim o yasak.
We bombing, we bombing, you don't want no smoke like ramen. We bombing, we bombing, you don't want no smoke like ramen. We bombing, we bombing, you don't want no smoke like ramen. We bombing, we bombing, you don't want no smoke like ramen.
Bomb squad, we loading up coats. We coming for throats, check your cell phone, folks. We don't leave no notes. Trick up our sleeves when you go ghost. Bomb squad, we loading up coats. We coming for throws, check your cell phone, folks. We don't leave no notes. Trick up our sleeves when you go ghost.
We bombing, you don't want no smoke like bombing. We bombing, you don't want no smoke like bombing. We bombing, you don't want no smoke like bombing. We bombing, you don't want no smoke like bombing.
Right now I'm getting funky with this loud pack, listening to New York Underground Radio, you dig me?
Sitting back, smoking on a blunt, listening to New York Underground motherfucking radio.
When I ain't in the booth shitting on niggas, or burning up that heavy kush, I'm listening to New York Underground Radio.
When I'm home, I'm listening to that underground radio, B-Dog, Dollar Bills and Stack Ones, big shout out, bigger, bigger.
From New York to Dover, Delaware, we listen to New York Underground Radio, man. If you ain't know, hip-hop ain't dead. It's just underground. What up?
Yes, yes, yes, this is CalOne the God, a.k.a. the Chef, the Little Better here. I'm coming back on commercial break right here with my man, Big DeeMo. Hip-hop kind of cool. Artists in particular, we specialize in oil painting. We got King Street, my man. He is an entrepreneur as well. He's into the clothing and he definitely is into the filmmaking. And before the commercial, we were actually talking to Ant. And the question proposed to Ant was, you know, how did you know as an artist when you're there, when you made it? Like, you know, you know what the hell you're doing. You know, at what point, how do you know? How did you know for yourself?
Well, I guess kind of the switching up a little bit from what I was saying before. I mean, you just kind of know. I mean, it's not like you need a validation from other people, but you feel like you have a certain amount of talent, skill, and or ability. And then you do things for yourself. You do things because you enjoy it. You do things because maybe you want to even challenge yourself. And then, you know, people say things to you. People give you compliments. People may even, you know, judge and criticize, give advice. You know, regardless of what it is, you're noticing, well, at least I noticed the kind and the type of input I was getting. And, you know, these kind of things, I don't want to say you don't forget, but they resonate a certain way. Cause, like when you hear certain things with basketball. Oh, yeah, you got this skill. You could do this ability. You could do this. Well, the first thing you got to do is go refine that and work on it. You know, it's the same thing with the drawing. You know, I saw that I had a certain innate and natural ability. And I just kept working on it.
Okay, that's fair. You know, so to follow up with that, what I want to ask you, King, is this. Once you knew where you were at, as far as, you know, being tutored by some of the guys and some of the different, you know, people around you in the filmmaking business, you know, and you've made a few films to date, you know, at what point did you feel like you could actually start teaching others your craft?
Well, most of it is usually when guys, you know, ask, well, put it this way, when guys ask me, you know, how you put together a film and who taught you and, you know, stuff like that. I don't hold a secret, man. I let them know. It's cool. Straight where, you know, where you can go and pick up your skills and talent. And, you know, most of the time I might give them a little detail and, you know, give them locations as far as where I went, you know, took the training. And then, you know, we go from there and break down some basic, you know, information in regards to the film business. And, you know what I'm saying? And like I said, you know, like, each one teach one. I don't hold no information from nobody, man. If I can help you, I can help you.
And I think so, that's proper.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, whatever I was taught, man, I just spread the love, man. You know what I'm saying? And people realize at that point, man, how, you know, how easy it is, man, to pick up a camera and go to work.
Right. You know? But it's really not easy. And DeeMo, you know, you got some expertise and a little bit of both of, you know, what these guys are doing. And so my question to you, DeeMo, would be this. You know, sitting back and listening to these two gentlemen talk about, you know, what they could do and what they could do well, you know, is there anything you would want to ask them, you know, in regards to their perspective craft?
Well, you know what? Listening to you guys, it sounds like, just like when I took the chances I did on the things that intrigued me and the things I love, that you dove in deep, you know what I mean? Jacuzzo, put on your scuba gear and dove in deep, and that's the only way you're gonna get those experiences and those answers. So I can appreciate both sides' perspective, you know what I mean? You can always learn something new from how someone handles theirs. We all got different roads on how we get there to each of our goals, and it just sounds like you guys know all the way in, and it's, you know, it's good info to give to the audience we have, just because there's so many different types of people. And for them to hear your experiences plus mine, you know, weeks earlier in the things that I was doing, you know, that's perfect. You know what I mean? Like, I can agree to a lot of the things that they're saying and how they look at it. And it's always going to be some kind of metaphor type situation, the way you look at it, because we all got to go through what we got to go through. So, you know.
Agreed, yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, can I kind of add on to that?
Sure, back
to Brian. Yeah, you know, it's funny because listening to DeeMo, I was just thinking about fear. You know, as accomplished as someone may think I may be in my skill or my talent, you know, I battle fear every day. You know, when it comes to that canvas and creating the image, you know, part of what, you know, I haven't gotten to the teaching level yet, but when I do get to speak to certain people and, you know, they want me to translate what I'm doing, I guess what I try and tell them is more of an internal battle, you know, fighting of myself and my own thoughts, because, you know, we all want to be receive a certain level of approval and, you know, admiration from our peers and things like that. So it's like you have to find that balance between finding your dream and goal and still giving it out to the people and be received in a type of way, but not take away from the truth you're trying to put out there, you know. So it's just a matter of a person, or me, myself, you know, realizing, okay, still do you and what you have to do, but put it out in a way, how can I put it, where it's received in a positive and an empowering way, so to speak. You know what I mean? But you have to absolutely overcome that within because of what's going on in the world around us. So it's a tough balance. Well, you know, it's an understanding you're looking for. Like, you're explaining your path, your
way,
to get the understanding is the ultimate respect, you know, like, oh yeah, I do get that, or yeah, I see why you did that, you know, that's the ultimate respect, not so much an applaud, or here's a plaque, or anything like that. Whatever you're trying to give off, if people can receive it, then, you know, that's the ultimate compliment to yourself, like, hey, I did what I came to do, and now they get that, they understand that, you know what I'm saying? So, that's a big deal, you know. Yeah.
Right. That'll be like King making a film, and then you see how the film ends, you're like, well, why did he end the film like that? So then you go back and watch the film again. Oh, now I understand why he ended the film like that. You know, kind of sort of that way, you know, kind of correlative to each other. And what I want to say is this. We are into the hip hop. I got to ask you guys, you know, I'm going to start with you first, King. How did you
What was your first perception of hip-hop when you first heard it?
I mean, oh man, I enjoyed the heck out of it. The creativity, the you know, the style and, you know, fashion from the 1970s to, you know, to current, the transition, you know, the thing.
Oh, so you don't know where those tight pants, that's what you said. You don't know where the tight pants?
No, I'm not with the tight pants at all. I'm just talking about the transition. Crazy. Listen to what Greg said, not for nothing. Everybody, you know, wear the tight pants. I'm just speaking in general as far as we call them bell bottoms. You know what I'm saying?
The first skinny jeans were bell bottoms.
Hey, but listen, exactly, but listen, if anybody wear the tight pants, that's their preference. I mean, so
that's
be it.
That's, you know, my, but that's the culture, like, that's the hip-hop culture now.
I'm not going to breathe, so I'm not, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
I wear the tight pants.
Nah, man, that's the thing.
But the music and, you know what I'm saying, like I said, the creativity, man, and the artists that have longevity in the business. There's a lot of guys, it's like, you know, they hit one hit wonders, you know.
That's true.
But for the most part, the guys that, you know, have that longevity, like the Jay-Z's and, you know, the DMX, you know, every now and again, Jada Kiss and, you know, the Locks and them, there's quite a few guys, man, that have that longevity that's still making music, man. And you know, they on top of their game, but I definitely love the transition.
Okay, got you. Well, so, and I want to propose the same question to you. You know, what drew you towards hip hop, man? What was it about hip hop?
I don't know. I think everything is hip hop. Just to be serious, you know, how can it not be? You know, my mom's back in the day, her afro, soul food, my brother, the music, the break dancing, clothes, you know, like you said, the 70s funk and soul, the 60s soul, R&B, I mean, just going up the scale, looking at what the culture represented. Yeah, we're wearing tight pants now, but that's what the culture is today. You know, in terms of representation, that's not all we see. We don't see, how can I put it nicely, some of the older rappers that have that longevity, I don't want to say lingering around, but they're still there. They're still not putting up the same numbers or out as frequently, but they're still being spoken about. They're still putting up their numbers when they do come out. You know, so right.
When it comes to me and actually listening to it, I may not listen to as much of the new music, but I'm more into the roots. Like, I'm into the thought process. So when I see a video about Jay-Z sitting there and he's going through all these tracks and he's trying to figure out what's what, you know, what I'm thinking about is, and well, not just that video, but where are they getting the roots of the music from? So I go
right.
Way back. So I look up where they're getting their samples from. So by me looking up the original songs to get the samples, that's taking me back into the roots of hip hop and how we're listening to music, how we're breaking down music, how we find the drums, the bass, the snare, and everything else. So I'm into it. That's it for me. You know, though, to correlate that, that's basically how music was made. I can remember being 10, 11, 12 years old, and we had all these records and dollar bills basement, talking about your dollar. And we used to go through all of these songs, and we would just look for something that we hadn't heard. Now, we hadn't heard all the James Brown samples. Everybody was killing James Brown and Funk Parliament, all different type of people.
Yeah.
So we were like, yo, we need to... All right, let's go into these reggae songs right here. Let's see what we can get. Let's find something out of Bob Marley. Okay, no. Let's go into these old salsa songs. Hey, Peter Fonte. Let's see what we can find, whether it's a bell ringing, a cowbell, a bongo sound, something. That was your TR-808. You know what I'm saying? When you're sitting there, and now you're putting the beat, then you add the bass line, you know, just throw a bass line from Bootsy Cop. You know, that is the essence of hip hop. And then when I think about it, correlates to the break dancing, it correlates to the graffiti. These are the things that made hip hop what it is, and I think you know, all three things together are being lost. One thing is getting more polarized than the other. You know, and to me, I think a lot of people are forgetting what it's about. Like, when I listen to all this music now, you know, I'm down here, I'm in Maryland, so they listen to a different type of hip-hop. And the shit they say, man, you say, I went to jail, I'ma do it again. I'm like, what the fuck is this? I was hitting the girl, her cho-cho was burning, I'ma do it again. So wait a minute, she burnt you.
Motivation.
You gonna do it again? Motherfuckers are crazy with what they're saying. You know what I'm saying? Like, I was telling my boy, I'm like, yeah, damn, I'm missing girl, damn.
Yeah, but you gotta understand something, right? And now, right, that might be a banger. You know what I'm saying?
No, it is.
Huh?
And that happened. I got laid out. I'm on the couch on the moon day. I got fired on the sun dip. The shit makes no sense to me. It's like they're talking, so I'm going to make a song. We're going to make a song with you. We're going to call it, people need to listen to what Kyle say. This is what I'm talking about. We're going to do a song. We're going to act up. We're going to talk shit. You know, you see, my point is this.
I mean,
you know, we're going to do a song. I'm going to make a song about the couch. What can we do on the couch?
Yeah, you can half take that account. We took a 5% change in the couch.
You can have me in the background. Rick James saying, "Fuck your couch."
that goes back to this guy Kachi 6ix9ine.
Okay,
I remember I expressed to you. Yes, Kachi 6ix9ine. I remember I expressed to you, you know, back in the days, in order for you to really get put on, you know, they were looking for originality, creativity. You know, if you wasn't unique and different, nobody would deal. Nowadays, like, anybody could get put on. So now when you get somebody that's unique, like the Kachi 6ix9ine, and people are hating on them. You know,
I understand.
Everybody's unique in their own little way. The problem is, I know this, people are upset when you have an artist that has reached a level in the early part of their career that's, you know what I'm saying, to where, you know, everybody love them. You know what I'm saying? They're getting millions and millions of views. That's been trying to get in the game for many years, and they have yet to reach that success, that level of success, and now they're mad. You have to.
You know what? I can agree.
You're gonna be mad. You're gonna be mad when you make sense. When you got bars like Nod and some pumpkin haircut of freak makes it off of BS that somebody wrote for him. You're gonna be mad.
Wait. wait, listen. Let me say this. I don't care how you look, basically, because you gotta live with how you look. Alright? My thing is, I saw him doing a freestyle on Instagram. He was making a mockery of the music. My son could do a freestyle. You know what I'm saying? Come on, man. Don't do that. Like I said, going back to the couch. What can we do on the couch? Going back to the couch. What can we do? You can make a song, get paid off the couch.
Who said that it's garbage? He's garbage. He can't freestyle.
It's an art for us, man. I was raised by the four kings, man. Rakim, you know, same Big Daddy Kane, Cool G Rap, Cash One. It's a mockery to what we were raised on. And I'm gonna tell you something. It's not the fact that he's on everybody's mask. The fact he's fake. He went from blue rag to red rag. Ain't nobody gonna have no kind of respect. Why don't we wanna listen to you and you jump rag, man? Like, it starts in the streets first, but that's what you're trying to portray. Like, come on, man. You're trying to portray the street life, but you're jumping rags. Come on, man.
Let me ask you this question, right? If you were his manager, right, and you have a formula to win that's winning, would you be good with that?
Say that again, or
you'd be upset. I said, if you were his manager or a record label, right?
and he's winning. He has the formula that's winning. You wouldn't be happy with that?
No.
Or if you had somebody that was lyrically gifted, but they don't know how to make a hit record for the radio that's radio friendly, would you prefer somebody like that, or would you prefer somebody that has a formula that's successful?
The industry is boxing, all right? So what's being played on the radio is being polarized by the record companies and the independent people that are supporting these artists to play their music repeatedly. It's being shut down our throats. This is not good music. All of this is not good music. But if you keep hearing it enough, eventually you're going to start seeing the cat, you know, or like I said, you're going to talk about, you doing the couch, look at you doing the couch, and the next thing you know, you got the whole world, look at you doing the couch, you know what I'm saying, but that shit makes no sense at all.
You know, just to add something to that, you know, based on the things that I study, all you have to do is listen to a song 7 times in repetition for it to be a part of your subconscious. You get one radio station playing that one song 7 times in 2 hours.
Who's paying? That's why a lot of people decided, like us, we're going to go independent, and we're going to play the people who don't get played. So this is why we don't, you know, this is probably the first year I really played any mainstream artist, but that's only because we interviewed one. You understand what I'm saying? And, you know, I got a couple of guys that do some songs with some established artists, and I've actually played their music. I usually don't do that, but, you know, because this is mainly for the underground, for the little people. But, you know, at the end of the day, you know, we still want to show out a good product, and that's where the rotation comes in. So at the end of the day, you know, what they're playing out there is being shut down out there. It's not the type of hip-hop that's like, oh, that's a... So it's not the type of hip-hop they're used to. I give everybody a chance. I don't necessarily say everybody's trash, but you're not going to sit here and make a fucking mockery of the music. I'm not having that. You know what I'm saying? If I was his manager, yo, keep doing what you're doing. But you better realize this is one big thing I would tell him. All right, when you start playing with that gang shit, the dude that's on the corner, they serious.
Right, all right, right.
You got bodyguards. So wherever you go, technically you're all right. But once you start, you better know them dudes you're fucking with is real dudes, and they will take your level. So you playing with fire when you go from place to place, and you start throwing all the extra stuff in it. You know what I'm saying? Because you're not built like that. You ain't no game. If you was a real true game maker, you wouldn't be a fucking musician.
Period.
You wouldn't be doing this. You know what I'm saying? Because the two really don't mix. I don't know too many dudes, either they transition, or I don't know too many dudes right now that straight banging in the corner and they are supreme hip-hop artists. Nah. You got to transition. You got to give something up. So you can't play gangster. You understand what I'm saying? And you start in trouble, man. You start in trouble for yourself. So as a manager, I can tell him that. And I would also tell him, take the bar serious.
My
thing is, when you start, you know, we're talking about spirit. You know what I'm saying? Everybody, the way they present stuff is different. I'll say this. Tupac Shakur is not a cypher MC. I'm not saying he couldn't have done it, but I never looked at his music like that. But then you can take more breath, he's a cypher MC.
I've heard him cypher.
You gotta get it where you fit it. I'm not saying he didn't. I'm just telling you what I thought, my thought process and what I've heard. I didn't correlate the two together. But I'm just hypothetically speaking, when you stand with the bars, you're serious. My point about both artists I mentioned is they're serious about the bars. They're not making a mockery of the music that we worked so hard to keep going on for over the years. That's my biggest beef with it.
And that's kind of the thing, you know, these men, they're artists, and they're creating something with their mind. Go ahead.
So, look, the situation is, if I was his manager, you know what, here's the situation. When you're a basketball player, you start at an early age, and you work on your jump shot, you work on your free throws, because you're in it to win it. I'm in this music game to win it. Uh-huh. If I'm his manager, I'll probably commit a suicide because he's just making one fresh round. That's it. He ain't going to be hot when he gets out of jail. He's not going to be none of that. And the thing is, only these kids
that like Skittles, that like eating that candy crap up, dude. But all the real MCs, all the real listeners, they don't appreciate what he's doing because it is a mockery one. You know what I'm saying? If I'm his manager, no. You know, it's not about the money for me all the time. I know how to get money off of music, you know what I'm saying? But for him to keep giving me money that way, that's not good money, man. You know what I mean? That comes with a lot of stuff. You talk too much, one, to be gangster, two, you're running your mouth and you're provoking people. You should be making classics. While you're over there running your mouth about nothing, make some classics. Like, your titles to your songs don't even make sense. A Bertha and Koopa and this. Like, what is that? That ain't nothing. These kids are eating up. And you know what? I'm going to just say this. I'm going to say this in the nicest way possible. When kids raise kids, this is what happens. When kids have kids to raise kids, they ain't staying in school. They ain't studying vocabularies no more. Of course, music's going to drop. The guys that I know, we was chasing dictionaries. We was chasing thesauruses. All that, we wanted to know what it meant. We wanted to have another word for that word. We wanted to be better than ABC. You know what I'm saying? Because that's the bubblegum rap now. Me and Todd, we over here in the hot rod. Like, we could have, come on, man. Like, come on, man. Be paint, use your paintbrush. I can't, you know, I've been doing this music stuff since I was six, and I take it all personal. I worked my butt off with no help, no whatever. I've had four contracts, and I didn't have no one taught me music, no nothing. I worked at it till I got my jump shot right, till I got my three-pointer right. You know what I'm saying? Because that's what I'm in it to win it. I'm not in here to play no games or to be a sub, or I just came off the streets or none of that, man. And that's where it's at, like. Now I'm telling God truth. I'm his manager. I'm like, look, kid, quit. Just quit until you get it together. Because I don't want that money like that.
Look.
I still feel the boy.
Maybe I was misunderstood. What I meant by him being, you know, he's winning right now.
Well, he's winning.
You know,
he's winning.
That success level is.
He's in jail now.
Say it again.
He's in jail now. I don't know if he's winning anymore. Yeah, he didn't pass his GED. He had to suspend his, the whole thing about being a pedophile. That happens. If he don't pass his GED, he got to go in. He didn't pass it.
I thought he did.
Nah, he didn't pass it. He did a video and said, this is my last day on the street.
Oh, shit. Well, I heard that shit.
Wow.
What I was going to
maybe he coughed up some money, he's out now, but initially, he did a video from New York saying, this is my last day out, someone come and get me. He's walking to the street with his goons, and nobody's trying to even provoke him. You know what I'm saying? He's just saying, this is my last day out, somebody come get me. I don't see nobody running up on me. Of course, like many times that we come from the show, I'm in an undisclosed place in this place. Nobody knew where he was at. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, he's still provoking people. You don't know what it's monsters in there that don't give a hell about what song you came out with. They gonna be like, did you diss my side? Did you diss my rag? You know, and you're a pedophile. Mm-hmm. Trying to make you do better than that.
I can tell you that much. That's a rap out there. You ain't gonna do that out there.
No, and then he's pedophiling, so, you know what I mean? And then another case just came up saying, a girl saying, they hooked up when she was 17 and he was 19. Like, the dude likes little girls, you know what I'm saying? You go to prison, there's about 20 dudes waiting to get you. They gonna stick you. In both ways. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, man. Right. I think she's crazy, man. Right. But what I want to do is this. You know, I want to say this has been a pretty great interview, actually. You know, just hearing, you know, about art on two different levels, two very respected men in their fields. That would be Big Ed and King Streets here hanging out with us at
Big Ups to you guys.
On Tap Radio 2018. We thank y'all very much. And what we're going to do is this. We're going to go to a station identification at this point. And what I want to do is I'm going to come back and I'm going to close out this interview. So everybody that's listening, you're now listening to Full Tap Radio 2018. Big DeeMo, Big Ant, King Streets, and CalOne with a little bit of hair. We're going to take us off for a quick station identification. And we're going to come back and we'll wrap up, fellas.
Yo, this is CalOne the God, aka the chef with the long hair. And I'm here on New York Underground Radio, Saturday Night Smackdown, the Dollar Bill, Dollar Make Him Holla, aka the Collector. And we're here playing your shit so that he can collect it. We're on from 9 to 12, Saturday, Saturday Night Smackdown. Let's do it. We'll be right back.
My ex like jail, cause I'm never going back. If I'm stuck, quick bail with a stack, fuck mail in a pack. I take it myself, no license or belt, or no wife or no help. Stealth long enough that my enemies forgot that my tendencies are plot, Hennessy's a rock. Whatever you twist it on, push numbers on your block. Enlisted calls, why risk it all for a victim, y'all? Eat till I'm sick and the biscuit cough. It's gravy, but maybe I need to go back to potatoes in front of the gat when it unstable in fact, unable to sympathize. Break down the picture to pixel size. Stick you like butt when it crystallizes, and they having a crisis from my missile size. Make it clap when it bounce. Homie getting slapped and we bounce. Better be strapped when it counts. With the sex to the tech when the gangsters around. Make it clap when it bounce. Homie getting slapped and we bounce. Better be strapped when it counts. With the sex to the tech when the gangsters around. I don't post up much, maybe IG, mama here's a close up. My model is a bottle of bravado when the howl leave them shot up like they trying to get their dose up. Pretty young thing, get your throat touched. Jack Daniels, the only thing that's coked up. Take it straight up, strong arm robbery of any hater or baller. Read about him in the paper, a caper only committed if magma, I'm starving. Somebody got slumped whenever we jogging. Memory awesome, I remember the spot where Kendrick was cop. Bench of the block and centuries of lock. Suspension was shot, Demi's was cock and Kenny was knocked. Then he was locked, so Remy was pop when he came home, waiting on the jokes. Niggas getting money, but they hating with they looks, huh? Make it clap when it bounce. Homie getting slapped and we bounce. Better be strapped when it counts. With the sex to the tech when the gangsters around. Make it clap when it bounce. Homie getting slapped and we bounce. Better be strapped when it counts. With the sex to the tech when the gangsters around.
Commercial rappers no more.
It's the champ with the crown from that New York underground. You fuck around, I have your whole block town underground.
If you lost the fucking streets, it's your fault.
New York underground radio, the shit. It's all love. Come and show your talent if you spit.
Fucking with commercial rappers no more.
New York underground secret society. Dog stack dollar, they all got their eye on me.
If you lost the fucking streets, it's your fault.
I smack them, crack them, I black them, drag them. Flow water, spit fire like a fucking dragon. I know what y'all thinking, when they found me. New York underground radio champ, crown me.
We ain't fucking with commercial rappers no more.
I'm getting money, baby, so niggas can never play me. Fuck that hot station, New York underground play me. Five songs in rotation, a few niggas hating. I wrote this 16, sitting in probation.
If you lost the fucking streets, it's your fault.
See the seats, grab your popcorn. It's New York Underground Radio.com. And we locked on, bitch, we locked on. It's New York Underground Radio.com, nigga.
All right, guys, we're back here. Well, we're here with my man, Big Ant, CalOne the God, King Street. We were just talking about stuff going on in the industry. We're about to wrap it up here, so we got closing remarks from anyone?
Yeah, well, around artists, rap artists, what I mainly was referring to is unique sounding artists that no matter what type of lyrics they come up with, it's just their voice.
The flow, you know, I got you.
The flow, you know. That motivates listeners into wanting to buy their music. And you don't even have to be a gifted rapper. It's just your voice. You know what I'm saying? Whereas you have other artists that is vocally gifted, but their voice doesn't, you know what I'm saying, move.
Like that, got you.
Right.
It's like this thing, like, the ODB.
Right. The reason why I give Tekashi 6ix9ine a little bit of credit is just because his voice and just him being a little unique. Whether it lasts or not, one would never know, you know. But he has successfully made maybe over four or five hit songs. And that's again, true. Like I said, the kids are sucking it up. They like him. A lot of other people dislike him.
It's just about pressing play. All those kids do is press play. They don't even know the words. They just moving their mouth, and then the good part comes up. Listen, I'm a little bit of biased because he dissed my whole side, so I'm going to say that. But, yeah, did he come out with hits? He came out with hits. They don't make sense, and they're garbage. You know what I'm saying? You'll end up on VH1's One Hand Wonders. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, other than that, that ain't his voice. That ain't even his voice. That's his voice. That's real DMX's voice the way he talks. If you ever heard Daniel talks like a little kid, and then he's like, I'm out on the mic. Like, you have to become a whole character, like a professional wrestler, like Ultimate Warrior during your promo. Yeah, come on, man.
Let me touch base.
The guys have a whole Tony to shake the ropes, sick of the holster.
I respect what you said about him disrespecting your side. You know what I'm saying? When you in this music business, the best thing you want to do, man, is, you know, the first thing you want to do is make sure you just, you know, focus on your career and leave the beef, you know what I'm saying, from different coasts alone. You know what I'm saying? Stop playing superhero, you know, stop, you know,
That goes to the advice that you're getting from the people that are around you. Right. And some people like to keep themselves relevant in social media about saying shit. But see, it's a different thing. You can say this and say this and say this around the people you're around. You get on the West Coast and somebody catch you and be like, this motherfucker said what? You can make sure you don't get back home. You can get home. And this is the motherfucker that is on the corner. Not the motherfucker that's listening to your music. They just hear about social media, about what you said, and they're coming to get you. So on that note, I just feel for the better life. I always think they got good, you know, dude, you got a
shout out to Young Blue.
He's hot right now.
Shout out to Young Blue for going hard on Tekashi and the music video, No Fly Zone. Shout out to Young Blue. And Young Blue is not, Young Blue is a Hispanic, and he went hard on another Hispanic without using any N-words, any of that. Just to show you what coach he's brought. Right. You know what I'm saying? Young Blue and Hard Tekashi.
Right. Yeah, it's a lot of Tekashi good songs out there, you know, but not to spend any more time on Tekashi. You know, I want to say thank you to Ant and King for coming through and allowing us to interview them and getting to their lives as artists. You know, this is something we'll pick up and we'll do again. You know, actually what I want to do, we'll probably do this at different times, is just do a whole show. You know, where we actually have, you know, their topics that we're going to talk about in regards to, you know, some of what's going on out here, and definitely some are, you know, definitely hip-hop related. You know, it won't be so much about us individually. We're going to talk about everybody else because this is what people want to hear. They want to hear us talk about everybody else or correlate to what everybody else is doing, and this is what we're going to do. You know, very happy to have y'all here. We're going to do this again. Sure, you know, we're gonna make this a real clean thing, and we got a lot of work to do too. I just said, you fellas, we got a lot.
We're gonna do this.
We'll get them on at separate times.
That's what I was gonna say.
Different shows, but just keep having them on because you know the personalities are dynamic. You want
great,
you know. Actually, this is like probably the first real. You know, I don't even say that. It's probably maybe the second, you know, I'm not even going to say that this shit. You probably hear about like four kind of seriously themed interviews. But this shit ain't going to be funny anyway, which is what I thought. You know, it's just another matter. If you put everybody together, you know, you get the personality, you get the info, you know, and I think that everything you guys got going on as far as your perspective, you know, entrepreneurships and, you know, just perspective skill sets for what you can do. You know, it's definitely correlated to
good info, guys.
You know, great info. You can hear, you know what I'm saying? You know, Ant went in deep, you know what I'm saying? The King definitely went in deep also, you know? And there's a couple of things I didn't get to touch on, but because the energy ended up being probably about an hour or so, you know, people got their attention span of flies. Soon, what we will do is do a corner of that. You know, I want to thank my co-host DeeMo for doing the things that he does and doing the things possible in order for us to do what we do. Once again, I want to thank Big Ant and I want to thank King Streets for coming through. Anybody got any parting words? Anything y'all want
to
say?
I appreciate you guys 100%. Can't wait to have you on individually.
my brother.
I appreciate
the
show, man.
The honor, man, the time, man.
Yeah, sure.
What y'all do, man, is necessary, man. I mean, just listening to it, the topics, the people you guys are not just having on, just me and King, but for the future. You know, it's about irrelevance, like you said. You know, we're talking about leaving a type of legacy and doing stuff, and, you know, you do want some type of longevity, but it's about not just about what you do, but how you do it, you know.
Yeah,
and that's a good thing. Tekashi 6ix9ine.
No, but that's
the
perfect way to end it.
Yeah, but we all have a certain level of creativity, man. We are all these different individuals on the planet. You mean to tell me that we have to copy one another? We have to be
alive?
You know, you can make your money being yourself without being somebody else, man.
Well, basically, you make your money without being a dick. Because a lot of people that their lives and their backbones are, they're groomed to be dicks from early. Okay, you're gonna be cool. You're gonna be like, you're gonna be a dick. You're gonna be a bigger dick than him. You know, and it's like, you know, to me, kind of keeping it, you know, just be yourself. You know what I'm saying? And you know, the young man is himself, and you know, you just gotta know what you're playing with. You know what I'm saying? I've been in the street, and this street shit is real. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Them ain't got no names on them. Them shit's hurt. I'm living proof. I can tell a motherfucker.
Yeah.
You know what I'm doing, America? You don't get caught up. And when them bullets start flying, all that touch shit you talking on the phone or on social media, that shit don't mean nothing. What you gonna do now? You bang.
Put some of these tough guys in Turkey when I was in Turkey, and they blowing up.
Turkey!
See how they react.
Yeah, Marhaba.
That's what I'm saying. You know, we have a lot of tough guys here that haven't left the country. And I'm not trying to disrespect nobody. I'm just saying, when you leave this country, it's real.
It's
you
real.
You gotta be a type of man. You gotta be able to carry yourself a certain way. Yeah, you gotta be able to operate not just in your city and your clique and your neighborhood, but there's a big planet, man. There's a lot of shit out there, and a lot of people out there in the world, they don't care.
The thing about what you're saying, man, is this. 99% of the people you talk to, you're looking down at them, so I think they're going to take you a little bit more serious than I do. You got a huge shadow of you looking down on you. I'm not a dude you weren't looking for you after school or you bothered his sister or something. You got a problem with that. So, I'm going to put you in a different category on that note. Yeah. I'm assuming that City Rise here, that's going to be funny today. I mean, just when we get into that whole basketball thing, that's going to be funny.
You know I got stories.
Oh, shit gonna be funny, you know what I'm saying? Let's not even blanch. I didn't even really introduce that part into the show. You kept a million to it. I was trying to get away from it. Because that's gonna be a crazy interview right there in itself, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, at the end of the day, I can't wait. We got some serious athletes on the panel. You know, and of course my man Vinny, you know what I'm saying? But he had the left hand jump shot, and he was still, you know, he was able to, couldn't stop it, he was left hand, couldn't let me do it. You know what I'm saying? You know, King had it going on, you know what I mean? He had the theme music, how he was playing, juggling and shit. You could hear the music behind him and all that, you know. Like that's the only guy in the hood that I could think of that had the music playing behind him. But anyway though, Vinny, we're gonna sign off. You're now listening to 2018 Phone Tap Radio. Peace, love, and hair grease. Hope you enjoyed the show. You know, we're going to chop it up again. This is CalOne the God signing off on MeUpInTheGodRadio.com.
Puts it up. Bang! From downtown!
Yo, this is CalOne the God, a.k.a. the chef with the long hair. We're live with Gray A, the super producer, from 9 to 12 p.m. You will hear Gray A doing the things that he do. On Fridays, we got Dogalicious, a.k.a. the Hollis Canine, doing the things that he do here live on New York Underground Radio. And last but not least, we got me, CalOne the God, a.k.a. the chef with the long hair, doing the things I like to do on Saturdays from 9 to 12 p.m. We are all live here on New York Underground Radio. And let's not forget, y'all make him holler. Because without him,
don't exist.
Started a channel, what's up with the YouTube channel? Motherfuckers so lost in the world, they don't even know a Remo channel. Niggas be like, what's his age? They don't know I'm AAA. I've been doing this shit since niggas was scared of the Y2K. Now niggas is insta famous, getting paid to be ignoramus, making over six figures for slanging retarded niggas. It's the age of the new hustle, gotta flex that brain muscle. Now phones the new eyes, now we're using hand muscles. So I just started my own lane and rearranged some things. Y'all heard of that boy Lies, he be the cousin of Lies. Got a pill of Scrivante Jones, who I'm well known. Or I got a bone to pick, like that white boy Eric. Dude. But demeanor, we still here, we'll never disappear. Similar to the internet and all his billionaires. But AAA, stay true to self, cause I'm a real millionaire. And I ain't a damn fool, the social media's here.
I thought I was done. It's still here. We ain't went nowhere. It's still here. You feel me? Shout out to Ken Ken on this beat, though. I see you, boy.
Let's go. This is CalOne the God, aka the Chef with the Long Hair, doing the things I do on Phone Tap 2018 edition. Compliments from NewYorkUndergroundRadio.com. We talking about dollar bill is in the house. We got me, CalOne the God, Stat Wizzy Ones, Firstborn Man. We got Big DeeMo, Doobie, aka Blanca from the Bronx. We got Kim Clark in the house. We got Lady Red and Sugar Shane doing the things they do. We got Rebecca S. Yo, we got Farouk the Great in the house. Lyric 757 is in the house. We got Spank Spank doing the things that he do, how he holding it on. On the west side, we got my man Chris Tobert holding it down. We also got, last but not least, my man Stick Diamond Eyes holding it down out of Queens. Do the things you do, big homie. Y'all listening to Phone Tap 2018. Let's go get it. Let's go get it. Let's go get it.